A very good morning to all the dignitaries present on the dais and my fellow student managers. I, Kopal Jaiswal, student manager of Sri Balaji Society, feels privileged to introduce you all to a very exceptional corporate leader present amongst us, Ms. Renu Bohra. Ma'am has worked in many multinational and public sector companies, having experience of over 24 years. She is currently working as Senior Director HR in Schenker India Private Limited, Gurgaon, a leader in logistics. Ma'am has worked in various companies, which includes Blue Star Limited, Bharat Aluminium Company, and National Aluminium Company in various roles in HR. Ma'am has done her management program from IIM Calcutta and MS in Psychotherapy and Counseling from IPMS. She has also been awarded a gold medal from IIT Roorkee in Masters of Philosophy in Computer Applications. Ma'am is also a life member of National HRD Network. So now, without any further ado, I would request Ms. Renu Bohra Ma'am to kindly guide us through your knowledge and experience.
Good morning to you all. I hope I'm audible to you all.
Yes, ma'am.
Visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. It was a very unique way of introduction. So people who have been here for a long time may not have felt the uniqueness, but I would like to share with you that I felt quite honored, humble, and it was a very unique way of welcoming your guest by, you know, the curtain getting up. I'm quite honored and happy to be here with you all. My special thanks. My special thanks to the directors of the institution, who I don't know how come yet they thought they should call me, because I don't think I deserve to be here. And my sincere thanks to director, to the various directors, and to Dr. Pardi specifically to give me a call and ask me to be here. I've been given some time to speak, but I will not take much time. I would like to hear from you more what you want to hear, because if you talk about information, it's already in the internet. If you talk about the welcome note, then I think Dr. Pardi gave a very good welcome note. So I am thinking that rather I would like to go for some interaction once I'm through with some of the thoughts that I have. So with again, with sincere thanks to people who invited me, I'll start this discussion. I am told the convention is called, or the theme is called, guiding the way into the 21st century. And when I heard it, I was always thinking that driving the way into 21st century. And I thought driving, and I thought about Riyadh, where women have been given the right to drive. And we are in 21st century. And there are trolls like, there will be more accidents. Women will meet other men outside the family. There are trolls like, if women go out and meet other people, then, and if their car breaks down, we will burn them and the car. So, and this is only a day back news. And we are saying we are in the 21st century. So 21st century, I would believe, is a metaphor for people who are in, for people who are in BIIB. It's about like the state of the art facility, a great grand future, a big corporate role. For somebody who is 50 kilometers away from Pune, it would be a different kind of vision. So the future depends where you are. I hope this is visible to you, because I think there's a lot of light here. Okay. A very famous science fiction writer said, the future is already here. It is unevenly distributed. When you read this, what comes to your mind? Anyone? What comes to your mind? Yeah.
Everything is scattered. Yes.
Future is not a linear path. We say that, you know, India is a classless society now, and you still hear or read news of somebody who is a Dalit, who sports a mustache and he's killed. A Dalit who rides on a horse for his wedding and he's killed. So that also is reality of India. And that is also reality of the world, where we still have racial abuses, where we still have the debate whether women should enter the workforce or not. 30 years back, it was a great debate. And if women will enter the workforce, what will happen to men? The work will get reduced, they will become jobless. And these questions don't even arise today. You know, these sound very funny to us. Yeah. Yeah, so when we say it is unevenly distributed, it is available to people, it is not available to some others. And then you have proliferation of things like Khan Academy. You have heard of Khan Academy? Yeah, so that was a brilliant idea of somebody, isn't it? To take, and who are these people? These are people like you. So students who are sitting here, you are future leaders. And the future is already here. So you are the leaders of today. That is the reason why you have organized a convention like this. You are being called as student managers by your director. And kudos to you for organizing such a big convention. The future is here. We need to move, or the market will move us. And the example that I'm going to share here is of Nokia, which already has been shared by Dr. Pani, that in 2007, Nokia owned well over a third of the mobile phone market, and about every second smartphone sold in the world had the Nokia name on it. By 2013, it had 3% of the global market share, global smartphone market share, and its market cap was a fifth of what it was in 2007. So what happened? Research by Yev Dawes, the professor emeritus at INSEAD, who literally wrote the book on the downfall of Nokia, found that the company failed in three distinct reasons, as per him. First, it didn't act early enough. Second, there was a system in Nokia, it was pitting internal stakeholders against another, and its leadership looked quite inwardly than outwardly. And here, you would be knowing about the GE example. When GE was at its peak, with so many organizations, you know, GE is a big body of various organizations, and almost all of its companies were either number one, number three, number five, or number 10 in the market space. And the GE head said, no, I would like to reduce it. I would like to sell those businesses which are maybe number five or number six to other companies. And people said that he has gone mad, but then I think it was a beautiful strategy to change things when you are at the top. It is said that what worked for you today to reach at this stage will not work for you to go to the next stage, isn't it? Those who are into bodybuilding or into sports, you would know that, you know, if you do the same exercise for a continuous period, in the initial period, it will give you results. After that, it won't give you results. And then you have to switch on to another exercise, isn't it? Thinking the unthinkable. What is unthinkable here? Anyone? Unique ideas, yes. Out of the box. So is it that we don't think of out of the box? If you sit in the boardrooms in the organization, you'll find there are many out of the box thinking which comes. But what happens? When they are raised by people laugh on it. And if you remember, in the freedom struggle, the earlier people who were freedom fighters, Lal Bal Pal kind of people, they said, OK, we only want a dominion status. They never could think that India can become independent of the British Raj, because maybe they had thought the British Raj also is good in some way. And then came Gandhi. And we said that we'll have Purna Swaraj. So it was unthinkable at that time. And it could have been done through maybe by a minority people who were quite educated, but then it was Gandhi who said that we have to go to the grassroots to mobilize people, because an independence has to be sustained. So India is the best example of sustained independence because we went for a grassroots level involvement. There was a public movement for independence. We looked inwardly into the society about things which, you know, like untouchability or women emancipation. Those were the subjects which were looked into. And there are many women colleges opened up, including medical colleges. So even if you look into the history of India, the way it was done, it was like unthinkable at that time. There was a huge mortality rate. And again, we come to that unevenly distributed independence. Even today, you see what happened in Gorakhpur. What is happening? It's not coming in media, but it is there. And there will be maybe 10 more Gorakhpurs like that. The same country organization, in the same country, where people have the best facility for maybe maternity benefits. So as young leaders and tomorrow's corporate leader, you may ignore it. You may say, how does it matter? But then, even if you are in full love with capitalism, the full-blown capitalism, and you are like a huge, lovers of capitalism, then also you would understand capitalism needs market. And where will the market come? People who are fighting for their bread and butter, they can't be a market for you. So that is the reason I think Tata says that industries are for society. And that is the reason that many companies in the last 60 years, 55% of the Fortune 500 companies have vanished away. And we know Tata is growing and diversifying and growing, and it's an institution builder. It built institutions like TISS or ISC or Tata Cancer Research Institute. So many institutes, they build up this particular corporate organization because it believed that the corporate here is not to only mint money. But unfortunately, many corporates believe that they are here just to mint money. And that is why they are never able to make their purpose align to the purpose of society. Can corporates thrive in isolation? So they have to work in the same society. Society is where they belong to and they give. Schenker, where I work, my organization, it's a 145-year-old organization. And I would like to tell you now that in the last 6 months, we are working on the purpose of Schenker. At the head office level, there's a discussion, what is the purpose of Schenker? There is a new purpose statement. There are value statement, the strategic beliefs being discussed. When you hear this, what is the feeling comes to you? When you hear this, that a 145-year-old organization, which is a number two in its field in the globally, is working on its purpose. What comes to your mind? Pardon? Trusted. Okay. Somebody else? Dynamic? Adaptability. Or preparing for change. Yes, all are correct. It means even an organization which is a leader knows that the way disruption is happening, the way Uber is coming up, and Uberization is happening everywhere. Aggregators are coming up. You have BNB. Your director spoke about BNB, where they don't own a single hotel. So those kind of structures are coming up. Have you heard of pipes versus platform? So pipes versus platform is that till maybe some time back, it was called that, you know, pipes are important. So you make a product. You look for a market, you push your product, because you say customer is king. And now we're talking about platform, where you are building a platform, aligning your producers as well as customers. So YouTube is a platform and not a pipe. And these kind of new strategic organizations, a new strategy of thinking will come up in future. And then how does, you know, new business ideas come up? New business ideas come up if you think of the future and not of the present. You know, generally we look at the present and go for 10% incremental growth, isn't it? Generally we look at the present and say and think that, you know, future is a projection of present. But if you see what is the future we are living today and the past, there is a huge disruption. I read of an organization very recently. You know, how many of you have got your mothers who have kept some childhood stuff of you? So, what have they kept with them? Pardon, photographs? Mark sheets. Okay. That's a very achievement-oriented parent. Then? Clothes, yes. Yeah, so women, mothers, you know, they generally, even fathers also, they keep small things. Like, I have kept a small teether of my son. I have moved houses, but the teether is still with me. So there's this organization which has come out with a very unique idea of, you know, making jewelry out of these. Jewelry out of a, lock of hair of the child when he was maybe 1 month old or 2 month old. Or lockets of breast milk, mother's milk. Or even the first wool, the woolen cloth that the child has worn, and you know, or the first tooth of the child. So these are coming up as jewelry. Now I'm not saying this is a big trend, but I'm thinking there's a big market for this, and there are very many women who are buying such jewelry and gifting away. And so who had thought about it? Unless you start thinking of, you know, new ideas, new innovations, then only I think that is the future of tomorrow. If you have read Yuval, the one who wrote a famous book, Sapiens. Have you read Sapiens? Have you heard of Sapiens? Yeah, so quite a bestseller. In a separate, I think, book or maybe an article, he wrote about a workless society. He said that, you know, 150 years back, there was no work in the society. There was no 9-to-5 kind of work, defined work where people, a huge majority will just, a city entire will get up in the morning, take a bus or a car and go to work. And there's a siren and then they come back from work. And human civilization has been there for thousands of years, but this going, getting up for work and sleepers and snoozers and whatever, this thing was not there 200 years back. And the way AI is coming up, there will be a workless society. You know, then what we will do? How are we going to spend our time? And who will pay us? Obviously, payment will come because maybe the governments will start paying because they would like less and less people to work. Everything will be AI. Please do read about it because, again, this is a futurist idea that what will happen in a workless society where everybody will have... Only 10% people will work in the very traditional format of 9-to-5 or an organized setup. Have you heard of gig economy? Raise your hand. GIG, gig. Or maybe it's called gig, I don't know. Yeah, so it's about freelancers coming up in a big way. You know, I was staying in my friend's place and she goes out for work and there is a gentleman or boy, young boy who comes to walk her dog. And it's a profession. So new professions are emerging. And the person maybe who is a dog walker, maybe he's a dog lover also, or maybe it's his need to earn a quick money, but he also has some other time to maybe study or do his passion. So this 9-to-5 rut will not be there maybe after 50 years or 60 years. So are we thinking of that kind of environment? Are we prepared for that? Are we thinking of becoming entrepreneurs? How we think about the future shapes what we do. So today what you do, what. It is going to, it is coming from, you know, the future. So, and how is very important here. So, does the idea of future scare you? Is it giving you anxiety? Or you become flexible because you think that anything can happen. So, let me work on it. The future definitely is unpredictable, but it is not a linear curve anymore. The disruption is there. Okay, when you hear that 50% or 55% of the organization in the Fortune 500 list in the last 60 years have vanished, what is the feeling it generates in you? Anyone, what feeling it generates in you? Scary? Pardon? You can surely be a bit louder.
Nothing is stable,
okay. So nothing is stable is a fact, but is it a positive or negative feeling?
Opportunity.
I think that is a very good, applause that thing, that you know, that this idea that nothing is stable, this generation is seeing it as an opportunity. You know, for a parent or for 60 or 70 year old grandmother who is not able to, you know, who's fiddling with the remote of a TV, for them, how are they seeing it? They're seeing it as an opportunity to learn, or they're seeing it as an opportunity. It is like, you know, times have changed. Oh God, I've become useless kind of thing. And this youth is saying that, you know, when we hear this thing, we see it as an opportunity. Opportunity for, to learn from their experience or failure to make organizations which are more sustainable, which are institutions in itself. A better way to predict the future is to invent it or create it. I think it was Peter Drucker or someone who said this. At times it's called invent it, or at times it's called create it. Do you believe in this? Can you give me some examples? Anyone? Or is it only a slogan to be kept, you know, just to make yourself feel so great? Apple? Yes? Pardon? Okay. Facebook? So I'm coming to the example of Schenker again. When Schenker, D.B. Schenker in Germany, is working on the purpose statement after 145 years of existence, they are again creating the future or inventing the future, because either you think that you are helpless because future, anything can happen, there can be an environmental disaster, you may have a huge refugee problem coming up, the way it came in Europe, it's coming up in India also, you have Brexit. Who had thought about Brexit? At the same time, you had the East and West Berlin getting unified decades back. You've got so many environmental issues coming up, climatic changes. You have political turmoil. You have got Trump coming up, which is highly illogical for people to understand what made him come back. But that is a reality. So, when you know that we are in very disruptive times, then the best thing is to start creating a future for yourself. So it will empower you. It will give you a lot of possibilities. You know, the 21st century slogan, who had given in India? I think you were born by that time. Rajiv Gandhi was the one who said in the late 1980s of everywhere, he used to say, humko jana hai 21st sadi ke upar. And everybody, and there are people who laughed at Rajiv Gandhi. And I would believe that, you know, at times when we approach the person again, then we realize the person's importance. And I would say he was a visionary. In the sense that in the late 80s, when everybody was against computer, he was the one, he talked about computers. And it is not only a mayor slogan. He was not an event manager. So it was not a mayor slogan. He said, 21st century, we have, this term, 21st century, became very popular in the late 80s because he had a vision of 20 years before or maybe 10 years before, and he said that we have to empower India. Today we are calling us IT superpower, but the foundation was laid at that time. Those of you, and you can check with your parents, that you know, having a landline was a luxury at that time. Even to connect, you had to go through an exchange. And this man, through his team, he brought Sam Pitroda, and there was a phone booth in remote villages where you don't have electricity, there was a phone booth. And I think it led to a lot of opportunities. Lot of opportunities in the way, because it's about being on the same page, being connected. That connectivity through that idea is what led to the revolution of IT. At that time, there were people who opposed computerization, but then it was brought, and we now know the boons or the result of that. Since I have come here, and I also need to share some kind of framework with you so that you can take it back home and read it and critique it. You know, as students, I would again request to you, don't take everything as a fundamental truth. You take it because ultimately it is people like you only who are thinking and giving it. So this is a framework given by Lisa K. Solomon. She has written a very famous paper called How the Most Successful Leaders Will Thrive in the Exponential Future World, where she says that there are four critical leadership skills which will count in future. Out of one is being a futurist. Are you a futurist? People who can think of future and start preparing. Being innovator. All this BNB, Uber, all these are like innovations, isn't it? Or Apple for that matter. Technologist, we can not say no to technology. And humanist. So I think the first three are very understood, and you may have your own take on that. I would like to talk about the humanist approach. The man of the century, the man who was declared as the man of the century by Time, was Gandhi. In India, you know, you have to say Gandhi, Gandhi at times because obviously it gives you political mileage, but Time is not an Indian magazine. So globally, he was called as the man of the century. Why? Because he was a humanist. He did not think about a chosen few and said, okay, let me get independence and close it. He spoke about those things which are now we are realizing. For example, he talked about panchayat. He talked about empowering village and the kind of exodus that we are seeing today. And this big city, Pune was such a beautiful city 20 years back. And you were not born, maybe. Such a pleasant weather. And I think it had one of the beautiful flora and fauna, particularly birds population. The place where I'm staying in the last 3 days, I can't even hear a bird chirping. And this is not the kind of world that we would like to inhabit. Surely not. We are not born to walk on, you know, metal roads or live in air conditioners. But this is what we have made because we did not realize on time. And coming back to Gandhi as a leader, and it is not about Gandhi, but about the thought process about khadi he spoke about. It was not about only self-independence. It was also talking about the organic cloth. Today, if you go to H&M, an organic t-shirt will cost you so expensive, you know. You can get a t-shirt on the street at rupees 200 and an organic t-shirt you will get maybe in 800 rupees or so. So again, we're talking about being organic, for fertilizer free food, or you know, a spring water. And these things are now looking like luxury while they were easily available to each one of us. Still, we have time. And I think this generation has to work on something which is very sustainable, something which is very out of the box, and which is quite unique. Just don't follow the crowd in the sense that if everybody is saying so, you know, you have a fascination for corporate world, which I can understand, because corporates have their own way to rule the world, or to rule the market rather. But corporates can always be redefined to suit the community need. And that is a need of the time. And I have a lot of hopes from people like you, because you are the new generation and you can think it in your own way. Coming to humanist, you know, I read the other day when Mandela was told that, you know, what is the most important leadership quality that you think is required? And Mandela, I think we all know, is one of the greatest human being or greatest leader born in this time, who fought against apartheid, who had thought about the white domination. You know, even today, the language that I'm speaking is not the language which I'm thinking. And that language has come because of the white domination of the world. And that's a fact of life. But he stood up against apartheid, and he did not do it violently. In a very sustainable, ethical way, he fought against apartheid. So he was asked this question that, you know, what is the most important quality of a leader? And he said, and I think it's very important for you all to know, because you are the leader. Today you are student manager, tomorrow you are the corporate leader. So he said, listening. So, and when he said listening, I'm reminded of, you know, many of the corporate stalwarts who come to the boardroom and, or maybe who come to the town hall and start addressing people. While Mandela said that first, whenever he goes to a meeting, he never speaks. He hears each one of them. If they're 20 or 40 in number, he would hear each one of them. And then he would speak. And I think it's very important to understand this. Maybe at this stage, you can see, you can look at it as like a voice of customer. You know that if, for example, at this stage, when do you feel most helpless? If you're not able to speak, isn't it? In the class also. When you have a viewpoint, and somebody's saying, this is the right thing, this is the right thing. And so listening is so important. And also listening gives you the opportunity to fight against the groupthink. You know, the Titanic sunk because there was a groupthink. We all know about it, you know. There was one person who said that this structure is not correct. But the group said, how is it possible? And it sank. So even in the boardroom, it happens that, you know, the group says, generally, you never say no to your boss, generally, and it's a fact. So it's very important for the boss to hear, to give you the opportunity to share your viewpoint. And here, diversity plays a very important role. Why, when we are saying that we are working to invent the future, why are organizations talking about diversity? We can also say, okay, diversity will come in its own way. I had a CEO to whom I said that, you know, I would like to increase the diversity percentage, the gender diversity percentage from X to Y. He said, no, don't work on it. It will happen. Our all hiring managers are very humble. They are very logical. So if there's a good woman candidate, they will hire. But it doesn't work like this, because people hire their clones at the end of the day. So you need, if you have to create a very diverse workforce, you have to work till, you have to work on today by saying that let's fix on a number of women whom we are going to hire. We have to double this number. There has to be a checklist. Similarly, and diversity, you may have diversity, okay. You may have a lot of women, you may have a lot of people of different race, different religion in the organization, but if it is not inclusive, then again diversity will not be able to work. So it's very important to have an inclusive society or inclusive organization. Otherwise, you will not be able to hear from some voices which will be silent, and then they will form a new organization. I was reading the other day about Silicon Valley. Many organizations came up in Silicon Valley from people who were working in big organizations, but they were not heard. And then they just thought that, okay, we are not being heard, our ideas are not being heard, let's form a new organization. And they left. So it's important for us to be open to hear the other voices. As I said, that I would like to give some framework so that it becomes a food of thought here as a takeaway. I'm just harping more on this particular paper called How to Be a Futurist. And it says that you can become a futurist. It is one thing is to be in awe with the future, oh, what will happen tomorrow, being anxious. Second thing is that to prepare for the future. And you say that, okay, let me work on the what are the various variables. So you think of the future and not of the present. And use a model called STEEP, S-T-E-E-P. You would have heard about it. It's also called S-T-E-E-P-D, STEEPD, where you take into the factors like social, technological, economic, environmental, political. And those who say STEEPD, D is for demographic. I'm not calling demographic here because I think demographic will be covered under social and economic. So, for example, if you're an insurance company and you want like to make some offering for the future, either you have the current offering and think, okay, I have to push this offering to the market, or you start thinking that, okay, after 10 years, what is the social, what is the life expectancy of people going to be? What are the factors which will increase the life expectancy? On the technological, what are those treatments will come in the medical field which will improve or which will be able to, you know, fight against chronic diseases or diseases like cancer or say Zika virus or things like that. Then you also think about what are the variables on the economic front, because as I said that in the future work will not be a 9-to-5 job for everybody. Already there's a gig economy which has come up. Freelancers have come in a big way. People will work on their own sweet will. There will be a lot of professions after AI, when you may not need real doctors also because there will be robots. So on the technological front, you look into the variables. You also look into the variables of economic, particular on the economic, because if there is no work 9-to-5 or regular salaried income, then will they be able to pay premium for your insurance product? Similarly, environmental. Is your product ready for dealing with a lot of environmental changes, issues, a tsunami, and on the political front, because there can be a new law. There are many regulations which keep on coming. For example, Supreme Court, path-breaking, verdict on privacy will definitely impact many of the organizations' guidelines or their models, working model. And then with these variables, you start working on four buckets, like what are the possible futures, what are the plausible futures, what are probable futures, and what are preferred future. And everybody would like to work on the preferred future. And then you think of what are the preferred future that you have, and then you start working backward. That when you identify your preferred future, then you go for backcasting and not forecasting. And backcasting is the act of managing a preferred future and then stepping backward to enable those things which will help you achieve that preferred future. So much for giving you a framework to think about. And last but not the least, there's a very famous Chinese proverb, and again it's a paradox. The fish is the last to know it swims in water. And what do you mean by this? Anyone? Anyone? Okay, can you be a bit louder? You are young people, you would have had a good breakfast, you know, in the morning. No. Okay, so if you don't hold me much, you'll have a good lunch. Yeah, so anyone, what does this mean? What do you think it means to you? You know, it may mean something different to you. Proverbs and sayings are not static. They can mean 1,000 things. Anyone, please. Okay. 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 Yes. Anyone else? Unawares of the fish. Okay. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. So a fish lives in water. The water makes the fish, isn't it? If the fish was able to live in land as well, it would have been a frog or an alligator. But it can only survive in water. It is water it is making the fish, and not the fish which is making the water. Similarly, you have been brought up and born by in an environment, in a community. Is that community only making you? But you are beyond that. So you need to understand that as human beings, we are far beyond what is the circumstances that have prevailed. At times we say that, okay, I was born like this. You know, I have studied in a vernacular medium, or I'm from a small town, or like I'm short in height, you know, and these, you only see your constraints. But then if you start thinking of a cross-cultural thing and also appreciate their culture, then it's a win-win situation for you. You are no longer a fish. You are adaptable and flexible, as somebody said. And last but not the least, I would like to close this conversation by sharing one of the things which I generally I was quite influenced with. You know, I was listening to Simon Sinek, and I think Simon Sinek, everybody would be knowing. And it is, and if you don't know, doesn't matter. There are many Simon Sineks, and one among you could also be Simon Sinek, or many of you. He is a thought guru. So he said that, you know, there was a very, very famous medaled gentleman who was called in a university or somewhere to speak. So there was a car which picked him up. He was accosted by people. When he went there, he was given coffee in a china, a beautiful, valued china. And then he spoke, and everybody clapped, and he was given a very warm welcome kind of thing when he was holding that particular position. Next time he went to the university, when he was no longer holding that position, he went to the same place as a listener or a speaker or one of the participants, and there was no car. He came in a metro. There was nobody who, you know, warmly welcomed him because he was one of the participants. And the coffee, and he was wanted to have coffee, and he went to the coffee station, and he had coffee in a styrofoam cup. So he said that we all deserve that plastic cup in our life. We all, including me. Today, if I am here because and I am here, and I'm being listened to, or I'm standing in the dais, it's only because of the position. So I should have that humbleness to understand the difference. That basically, I only deserve to be there, or one among you. It's only the position which is making me here. And when you rise to a good position, my dear friends, in your organization, then please remember this point, that you don't deserve that position. You only deserve a plastic cup, the way the armed janta deserves. Because of that position, you are there. And I think if you have that kind of understanding and humility, then life is very easy. With those words, I'll close this conversation, and I would like to make the house open for any interaction, questions, feedback, suggestions. Thank you.
Hello, ma'am. Good morning. This is Karthik Pandey from Balaji Institute of International Business. Ma'am, my question to you, Ma'am, my question to you is that in your long career in the field of human resource, I want to ask you that what difference that you see today and 20 years back in the work culture of corporates, and what all are the skill sets that are required in the new recruitees to cope with that sort of a culture in the corporate?
You're talking about the HR person. What is my experience that in the last 20 years, how have things changed?
Today and 20 years back.
So I think things have changed multifold in all the arena. You're talking about workplace very specifically. So in this workplace today, we have got people from various generation. Millennials are there. And people have different aspirations. So somebody who is 40 plus and has a family has a different aspiration. Somebody who is 20 plus has a different aspirations. I think as HR, generally, we are so policy bound. It's a policy manual at times that we forget that the customer, who is the internal customer, who is the employee, has a different need. And now, I think in the last 8 to 10 years, very clearly, people are realizing that one size does not fit all, and you have to take care of their aspirations as well. So maybe 10 years back when I used to organize birthday parties in my office, and if nobody turned up or if only a few turned up, I used to feel very angry. But now if only 20% people turn up, then I understand that these are the people who may need such kind of entertainment. Others do not need such kind of entertainment. So I think that understanding that, you know, every people's aspiration is different is to be understood. And second thing is that I think we should realize, and I think we have already realized this, that hierarchy at times kills the organization. You know, hierarchy is functional and should be only functional, which means you have to make somebody responsible overall for the particular function, and that is the person at the top of that particular department or function. But that is all. It does not make the person one above the other. Yes, the person has the privilege of taking all the options and using his or her judgment to decide, because that is a risk he or she is taking. You have to have a decision. You can't just move by consensus always. But yes, the times have changed. 20 years back, there was nobody talking about diversity. There was no one talking about sexual harassment also. But people are not talking about it. They're understanding that what is sexual harassment, what is harassment rather, what is harassment by any of the gender. And third gender has come up in a big way. So we, in the last 1 year, we have changed our hiring policy maybe 3 times. And the application form, we have changed 4 times in the last 2 years. We used to ask for photograph. We have stopped asking for photograph because now we understand that when you're asking for a photograph, you are building a ground for discrimination. Because, you know, at times you will like people who look like you at times, or you'll form notions about which religion or which region the person could belong to. And also we have stopped asking for gender. We have stopped asking for family details. We used to ask earlier, but we don't ask for it because when we hire somebody now in Schenker, India, we are hiring that person and not his family. Yes, we respect his family, but it doesn't matter to us whether his parents were working, not working. To us, the employee matters. So things have changed. A lot of voice of the internal customer is there. Initially, there was only one survey in 2 years, one employee survey. Now it is very frequent, very, very frequent. So there are many changes which have happened in the workplace. Inclusiveness has come in. There was a culture in which if you shout, then you are considered to be important, you know? The boss who shouts, the boss who makes others silent. Sir culture was there. It is no longer there these days. It is there in some organizations, but the organizations which are of value and progressive organization, inclusiveness, mutual respect, talking in you know, courteous manner has come as a part of work culture. Yeah, thank you.
Hello, ma'am. Good morning, ma'am. Good morning.
My name is Akhilesh, ma'am. Akhilesh from BIIB Finance. My question is, ma'am, you talked about how to think like futurist. But even though this development and innovation is coming up, in this current scenario, we have social and political restrictions that is not helping the students to think innovatively. So like student managers like us, what we should do about it and what steps we should take?
That's a good question. There is no straight answer to that. But in this case, I think you have won the half battle because you have identified the challenge. You are seeing some political and things like that is stopping us from development or move to the next level. So when you have been able to identify the challenge, that is half victory. And now you have to make others also realize that it is a challenge. You know, if I see a challenge and you don't see a challenge, for example, if people say that there is a climatic change happening and which can destroy the humanity or the survival of Earth, and if Trump says there is no climate change, then you have to make Trump agree. So similarly, if in your team there are people who don't agree to that challenge, nahin, it is not there. You have to make the person realize, you know, by giving examples, and then move forward. You know, dialoguing is the only way you can move, whether here in the institute or tomorrow in the corporate world. Nothing will replace the dialoguing because you have to work together to take things forward. With team.
There are no women who are asking questions. You may not have any questions. You can give some feedback. Yes, please. Yeah.
It's a beautiful question. Again, will it impact the decision-making power? Yes, it will impact because you'll have a lot of variables in front of you to take decision on, isn't it? When you have AI, you have got big data as well. You have the machine memory or machine learning is there. So you have a lot of things to come to a maybe more effective decision-making. So yes, it will impact the decision-making. Is it going to replace our ability of decision making? I don't think so. It's an easy answer, but I don't think so that it will replace our thinking because it depends on us how we are utilizing that AI. It depends upon us. Yeah. Thank you.
We are grateful for the time and effort you took to share your thoughts and experience and making us realize that the future is here and we need to take a move now. Further, for sharing your thoughts on thinking the unthinkable, you made us understand better by quoting real-life examples and by talking about success stories like Uber and Airbnb. Ma'am, you also explained us the four critical leadership skills which are necessary to become a leader. We take this as a learning from you, ma'am, that it is better to create our future than predict it. Once again, we thank you, ma'am.